So we have gone over Zener diodes, how they work, some of the concepts, how they're used in voltage regulation. We've gone over it conceptually, gone over it mathematically. We've gone over half wave and full wave rectifiers and shown how those can produce a certain voltage that you want and how we can even smooth those out. But we haven't gone over and actually talked about how a Zener diode works as a voltage regulator in real life. It's the first time I heard of a Zener diode and the way that you can put it in reverse bias and then it'll give you exactly the voltage you want. It's like, this almost seems like magic. This is fantastic. This is awesome. But the more I learn about it, yeah, it's still awesome, but it's complicated. There are a lot of things to take into account. So right now, in this very, very simple setup, we have four things that we need to worry about to make sure that this is working right. And so I'm going to go over them really quick, and then we're going to mess with things and show why it's such a challenge. Now, the first thing that we have here is actually the voltage supply. So whatever the voltage is coming in is a variable that you have to worry about. The second thing is the Zener diode itself and what it's rated for. In this case, it's rated for 5.1 volts. And then we've got our load, which this is anywhere between basically a 0 ohm load and a 1000 ohm load. And then we have here a resistor that's sole purpose in life is to make it so the Zener diode doesn't blow up when there isn't any load and the voltage goes too high. And in this case, it's a 100 ohm resistor. Now, in an ideal circumstance, this 100 ohm resistor would be pretty high power. It'd be something along 5 watts or 10 watts or whatever. Unfortunately, I don't have that many resistors lying around that aren't basically 1/4 watt or even 1/8 watt. And I was looking and I couldn't find anything. So we're stuck with a 1/4 watt 100 ohm resistor to act as the safety barrier there. And that's gonna mean that we can't go too high with our incoming voltage as we're testing it. But that's the thing. That's the thing. That is one of the challenges of doing all of this is you have those four variables. And as one of them changes, everything else has to morph or you're gonna lose efficiency or you're gonna have other problems. So let's get into that. And let's see if I can be coherent when I am going through the different challenges here. So the main goal of all of this is you want your voltage across this Zener diode to be 5.1 volts. That is the main goal of everything. Now it needs to be 5.1 volts in every circumstance. Now that's never going to happen if your input is below a certain threshold. If your input is 5 volts, you're not gonna magically get 5.1 volts above the across the Zener diode. And actually, as you measure it, let's get this going. So right now, if I go below about 5.7 volts, you can see that my voltage across the Zener diode drops. So not only do you need to have 5.1 volts, you have to have a little bit over 5.1 volts for it to stay where it's supposed to. And that's flashing all over the place because I'm not holding this properly. But then once you get up above that 5.7 volts, you can see it's stabilized and anything over that, and I still get that 5.1 volts. So that is the first thing that we need to worry about. The second thing that you need to worry about is this resistor right here. This resistor, as I said, is basically so that you're not losing everything right here. So just imagine that we have the load at no load, so infinite resistance on the load. And then I have 8 volts across there, and this is going to be 5.1 volts. If I didn't have this resistor, it would be 8 volts across this. This is just basically going to be conducting, in an ideal world, an infinite amount of current, and that is not an ideal thing. So we put this resistor, just like you do with an LED, to make it so that you don't have some crazy current flowing through this when there is a higher voltage across the diode than you want. So that's great, but at the same time, all of the current that is flowing through this gets turned into waste heat. It's just completely wasted, dissipated power, and that's not ideal. So you want this to be as low as possible, but then if you're going to have 15 volts coming in and you have a 1 ohm resistor there, that's not going to be enough to protect the diode. And if you have a humongous resistor in there, then it's going to make it so if you have a very large load, any current that wants to go through your load has to go through this, and it's going to be burning power as it drops through that high resistance resistor right here as well. So that's an interesting challenge that you need to figure out exactly what your expected load is going to be here to make it so that this can handle both having no load or basically a huge load. So anywhere from, I don't know, 1 microamp up to 1 amp or something like that. That's really where you have to do those calculations to figure it out. And again, we're not going over the math here. We have another video in that one we go over the math and talk about it. And also probably really recommend you go to CircuitBread.com to see that math worked out to make it easier for you. But moving on, We have this right now. I have it set up so it is a 1000 ohm load. And I'm doing that because as I'm sitting here, I'm worried about burning out this 100 ohm resistor. So right now it is 0.6 volts across 100 ohms. That comes out to about 6 milliamps. And man, if I can't do that easy math in my head, this is why I don't like to do math in front of the camera unless it's completely scripted, because I'm just gonna embarrass myself. But that's with this load being 1000 ohms. So let's drop the resistance here. So we are basically increasing our load. And you can see that as we go and we're basically having more of a draw through the load itself versus just through the diode, that there's a bigger and bigger voltage drop across this resistor. And not only does that mean that we're wasting more power in this resistor, it means that we are not going to have as much of a voltage drop across here. So now this isn't going to be 5.1 anymore because our input voltage isn't high enough. So now we're only at 4.6 volts because this is trying to draw so much current that it has to go through here, and that's dropping too much voltage across that resistor that you're now not getting enough voltage for this Zener diode to be able to work in its capacity. And so now you need to turn up the voltage a little bit to be able to still maintain that correct load on the whatever the load is. So I hope that just gives you a rough idea of the complications and really the trade-offs that you have here. I think this is a perfect microcosm of what engineering is all about. Is you can't just say, oh, well, let's just do as much as we want, as big as we want and everything, because if you make things as big as you want, then it's gonna be incredibly inefficient. But if you make things too small and you're going completely for efficiency, then it's not going to be able to handle a wide range of loads and you're gonna be, oh, well, now that I switched the load, I have to change all of these things, and that's not ideal either. So as much as this drives me crazy because it's kind of like this weird juggling act, it really is a perfect example of what it's like to be an engineer and to try and look at what your requirements are and look at how am I going to make this in a way that fills all those requirements and is inexpensive and robust and does everything that it needs to do. So that's it. So voltage regulation with a Zener diode. I guess the summary is it's a challenge, but it's worth it because this is the basis of all modern power supply things. This and a full wave rectifier, switching mode power supplies. You have a lot of different ways of approaching it, but this is one of the key ways that most things have their voltage regulated right now. And it is interesting. So hope that was helpful. Hopefully I didn't scare you. Hopefully that was more of a, hey, that's a challenge. I'm going to go and approach that and see what I can do about it. And if you liked that, if you found it interesting, please leave us a like, subscribe to our channel, leave any comments or questions in the comments below or on CircuitBread.com, and we'll catch you on the next one.